Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Let me make sure I'm on the right slide. Yes, okay. So hello and welcome to the 2021 NCWIT Virtual Summit on Women in IT, which continues to be the world's largest annual convening of change leaders focused on significantly improving diversity and equity in computing. My name is Brittany Anderson Martin, and I am the NCWIT Workforce Alliance and Regional Initiatives Project Manager. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our final event of this series, our Conversation of Change, Conversations for Change series that have been happening this past week for our summit. Our Conversations for Change series feature speakers with a diverse range of perspectives and hopefully provocative ideas and worldviews. Throughout this series, we've shared a video showcasing the outstanding work of our 2021 NCWIT Collegiate Audience Collegiate Award recipients. So today's video will highlight awardees at the graduate level. Please join us in recognizing and honoring these awardees and more at the virtual 2021 NCWIT Collegiate Awards Showcase that will be happening on June 3rd. So please enjoy this video.
Hi, my name is Farida Tasneem. My project concerns the development of a skin-like sensor that allows you to communicate messages using muscle movements. When laminated like a sticker on the face, it allows people with neuromuscular disorders such as ALS to communicate. This project stands out because its design was informed by quantitative analysis of strain data from the face of individuals with and without ALS. This allowed for accurate decoding of subtle facial gestures while reducing data bandwidth in bits per second to three orders of magnitude lower than the industry standard. As I'm rounding off my master's in biomedical engineering at MIT, I'm switching gears in my PhD to study the physics of complex systems to help us better understand general principles about how living systems arise and function.
My name is Angelique Taylor. The goal of my project is to enable robots to deliver supplies to healthcare workers as they treat patients. However, patients are often situated in hallways, which is a great safety concern because robots have the potential to interrupt patient treatment. To address this challenge, I designed a system that enables robots to observe a patient treatment and predict how acute the patient's condition is. Then the system uses this information to avoid areas of critical patients. In the future, I validate my system on a mobile robot in a medical training center. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Hannah Pasandi, and I'd like to take a moment to say thanks to the NCWIT Collegiate Award Committee for recognizing my work on a learning-based framework for self-driving design of networking protocols. This project aims to replace the current human-based protocol design with a learning-based framework that is able to learn how to adapt the networking design protocols based on the network condition, application requirements, and the user objectives. And I really hope to see this in practice. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Isabel Petrola, and my project is TLDR, Extreme Summarization of Scientific Documents, in which we built a model that automatically generates TLDRs of scientific papers. TLDRs are short, single-sentence summaries that communicate the main points of a paper, and they can be easily incorporated into a scientist's workflow to help them more quickly decide which papers to read. I'm currently pursuing my PhD at Johns Hopkins University, after which I hope to be a professor in computer science.
My name is Estrat Qasim Jaradat, and I'm a PhD student at the University of Texas at Arlington. During the last year, I've been working on Cherry, which is a system that detects and corrects cherry picking. Cherry is a state-of-the-art machine learning tool that is trained to pick up selection bias in text and then generate an alternative unbiased text. In the future, I hope to continue studying automatic methods to combat disinformation as a computer scientist.
My name is Lexi Rangioni, and the title of my project is High-Resolution Quantitative 3D Imaging of Blood Vessels and Bone Cells in the Skull. In my project, I created an imaging platform that allows us to observe how blood vessels interact with bone-forming cells during skull bone growth and healing. This insight will help us accelerate the development of better treatments for patients suffering from debilitating skull injuries. In the future, I plan to pursue a tenure-track faculty position and to start a lab focused on developing regenerative therapies for orthopedic conditions.
NCWIT appreciates the support of our sponsors, without whom recognizing these technologists would not be possible. Thank you to the NCWIT Collegiate Awards sponsors, Amazon, Qualcomm, and Palo Alto Networks. And thank you to NCWIT lifetime partner, Apple, for its generous support of the entire Aspirations in Computing program.
Okay, so I received word that we are having some technological difficulties. So please give me a second while I stop sharing and then reshare. Hopefully that will help us clear up. Okay. Okay, and let's see, someone will tell me if that is not sharing properly, but I'm gonna keep going. Okay. Okay, so, we would like to thank the sponsors that made this event possible. And thank you in advance for your patience, as we do currently experience technical issues. And if we experience any other bandwidth issues, thank you so much for just staying in there with us and remaining patient. I encourage you to post your questions, comments, and anything else to our question and answer board throughout this session, or to upvote any questions that you would like to have answered. We'll answer as many as possible at the end of the presentation. So now to get our conversation for change rolling, I want you to take a second to imagine being able to quantify the economic impact of racism and sexism. That's exactly what our speaker today is doing. Dr. Lisa D. Cook is currently a professor of economics and international relations at Michigan State University. Her research explores economic history, economic growth and development, and innovation. Dr. Cook's accomplishments are numerous, to understate it. I encourage you to visit ncwit.org to read her full bio. She literally is hashtag Black Girl Magic. It's insane. I'm going to pull a little bit from her bio and add a little bit to tell y'all about her. So prior to her appointment at Michigan State University, she was on the faculty of Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government. She was also the deputy director for Africa Research at the Center for International Development at Harvard University and a national fellow at Stanford University. In addition to serving on numerous boards, including the National Science Foundation, she is an Edison Fellow at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. She has published a number of articles, book chapters, and working papers. And to steal a line from her LinkedIn profile, sometimes she advises presidents, ministers of finance, and central bank governors on economic policy, just sometimes. If the sheer magnitude of her professional accomplishments has not astounded you, she also speaks 5 languages: English, French, Russian, Spanish, and Wolof. Dr. Cook, welcome. It is such an honor to have you here with us today. I am going to turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Brittany. I am so delighted to be here. Thank you so much to NCWIT for this incredible invitation and this incredible time, at this incredible time. So I am just sharing my screen here to get us started. Lost Einsteins and Gladyses. Finding and retaining missing women in innovation. And this is what I'd like to talk about today. Just to motivate it, I'd like to start with a few stylized facts. Ideas and innovation are essential to economic growth. We know this from Nobel Prize winner Paul Romer, who based his research on endogenous growth and developed ideas related to growth that governments, that countries can undertake themselves to enhance the living standards of all people in the world and all people in that particular country. This goes back to Guerrillicus, 1957, where patents have been related to economic activity. So my focus is on patents. So I'd like to start with some news before some facts. We talked about this a lot when it happened. Certainly it was said by Larry Summers, and he may have been, the whole conversation started a big conversation, a larger conversation in America about women in the sciences. And economists have been those among those who are trying to answer why so few women enter scientific research. The research that I'm doing, it's typically called the Idea Gap in Pink and Black, attempts to answer not only this question, but also those related to innovation and entrepreneurship. Let me tell you a bit about this research. And this research was done in, it feels like, an antediluvian period, a period when Google patents wasn't available. So I'm going to describe the work and I'm going to describe the methods, but I'm also going to talk about policy prescriptions and how to get more women in this endeavor. Using the patent data for the economics of innovation and technical change was pioneered recently by Hall, Jaffe, and Trachtenberg, 2001, this NBER data set that had an overview of information on inventors, geographical area, owner, and technology. And there were a few other papers with this common set of co-authors that used patent data to obtain information related to innovation and technical change. So one thing that we know from the initial work that I and others did is that African Americans and women have been increasingly involved at the beginning of this process. So when I'm talking about the innovation process, I'm talking about education, sort of training in STEM, and then training as an actual inventor. So practicing in a lab, practicing the trade that one has learned in a laboratory with other people and actually patenting, for example. And then the final stage is commercialization of invention. So whatever is produced in this period of training and then practice, we should see in commercialization. And commercialization is where, say, IPOs come from, and Apple and Google and other firms come from, other tech firms come from. So it's really important. This is a really important process in the innovation economy. So what I started looking at was women and African Americans who had science and engineering PhDs, believing that they would be the contributors to all these patents that I was beginning to investigate. And 1970, women had 9%, held 9% of science and engineering PhDs. By 2005, they held 40%, and that trend continues. For African Americans, it was 1% in 1970, and it was 4% in 2005. Different orders of magnitude, of course, but still moving in the direction of significant increase from that low base. And we see similar trends for both groups and master's programs. So again, these are data that I used in my initial research. I'll tell you a bit more to update that, but this is where women were obtaining PhDs over time in S&E fields, in science and engineering and health fields. You can see that has changed a bit over time, but for life sciences has been most prominent. More than half of PhDs in biology go to women these days. And certainly for mathematics has been sort of second behind the life sciences, and engineering has always been the smallest field for women since 1968, since these data have been recorded. We're looking at African Americans. We see a somewhat similar trend in the sense that life sciences have been most dominant, but it's not the case that engineering is where they've gotten the fewest degrees. This is varied over time. Sometimes it's been the physical sciences, and sometimes it's been mathematics. So these are slightly different, but as you know, for African Americans, we have both men and women in the data set. And again, as I mentioned, this same trend is true for master's degrees. So if we're updating this between 2000 and 2011, the share of S&E bachelor's degrees going to women remained roughly flat. More than half are still going to women in biological, agricultural, and social sciences. They declined in computer science, something this audience would know a lot about, mathematics, physics, engineering, and economics. So there's some movement in the wrong direction. And the reason I mentioned bachelor's degrees, not only would they be the foundation for PhDs, but for patenting, it's going to be bachelor's degrees that are most important. The share of S&E bachelor's degrees among African Americans continues to increase slowly. So just to put a fine point on it, women continue to enroll at relatively low rates. If we talk about the current period, engineering, 23% of degrees of S&E doctorates, of doctors in engineering, sorry. Computer science is 25%, physical science is 33%, and economics 38%. And same true for doctorates, that this is increasing slowly. But that only talks about the beginning of the process. At the end of the process, they appear on the face of it less engaged at the end. This is the period where you have the development and sale of invention. And this is an issue of great interest to economists, since innovation is a source of wealth generation and higher living standards, and also of significant wealth inequality. And the papers that preceded my work in 2010, 2011, we see that women commercialized, others showed that women commercialized their inventions less than their male counterparts, and that they patented less than their counterparts. So what did I find in my earliest work? I found that women and African Americans were actually assigning their patents to firms, or commercializing their patents at rates that seemed comparable to the previous literature. So for women, I found it was about 75%, for African Americans about 50%, and for all inventors obtaining patents in the US, 82%. And just to be clear, when you assign a patent to an entity, it can be a firm, it can be a university, it can be some other entity besides yourself. So my when I say firms here, I actually mean to entities outside of the individual inventors. So what we see is a puzzle. So we see participation growing from 1968 or 1970 with these degrees in general. What we don't see is this commensurate increase in patenting. We see gender and racial differences that seem to exist and persist at the end of the process. I would say at the middle and at the end of the process. So the questions that I had were, could we improve the identification of women and African Americans? Punchline, I'll anticipate what I will say later on. Yes, we could. If we account for foreign names, does that innovation gap still exist? And what's the probability of participation in commercialization in the universe of US inventors? So these are the questions I was trying to ask. And of course, I was trying to ask about what we could learn from all these new data, including what are the determinants of commercialization? Because if we know what leads to commercialization, to entrepreneurship for women and for African-American inventors relative to the population, we could figure out possibly how to close that gap. So the punchline of this research is that about this idea gap is that it's both closing and opening. It's closed and closing on the commercialization end. We find that the quality is comparable at the final stage. We show that the idea gap is open and opening at the inventive activity stage because we don't see women filing as much as we see others filing for patents. So we see this this gap at the very very beginning of the patenting process, but that's in the middle stage of the practice of invention. So that suggests that there's potential arbitrage related to wealth generation where opportunities are being missed. For example, a foreign origin contribution to innovation has possibly been understated among women. And I use that to try to identify more research. So let me just quickly go through the rest of the talk. This is now, let's say, innovative history, if you're talking about studies that were done in 1995. But I'm just giving you the groundwork for how we are identifying women better and what else we can do to identify women in patent data. Now, why do women need to be identified? Because patent data do not tell you what the gender of a patentee is, do not tell you what the race of an inventor is. There's no demographic data in patent records. So you have to be careful and comprehensive in trying to identify women and minorities in these data, or racial and ethnic groups in these data. So one thing that I found in an early NSF study was that to identify women, and this became a common way to identify women, it still is, in PAT data, you use the first named inventor to see if that were a woman. And this is a very crude measure because you would call a woman's patent one that has a woman on it, and that happens to be the first name inventor. And of course, they use in this 1995 study, U.S. address. Most importantly, they used common American names, largely English names. And one thing that I know from my other research and from having written my dissertation in Russia is that most people who are doing PhDs in the U.S. at U.S. institutions have a degree from a foreign university and a first degree from a foreign university, and that has been increasing over time. So what I decided to do, and I was one of the first ones to do this, is to use commercial software to capture foreign origin women's names. For example, Asian names, Slavic names, and the common English names that were found in that data set were Mary, Patricia, Linda, Jennifer, for example, and then some of the common Indian, Chinese, Slavic names that you would see in the PAD data were Rohini, Seema, Uma, Lin, Xiao, Sue, Tatiana, Irina, Svetlana, and Galina. So obviously we were missing a lot. I won't go into too many details, but I sought to improve on what NSF had done in terms of identifying women patentees. I tried to improve on the samples, got larger samples, tried to improve on this crude measure. I used discounting, which is now common, by attributing to a woman the fraction of a patent she represents. For example, if there are five people on a patent team, if there's one woman, one-fifth of the patent is attributed to that woman. This is all in an attempt to measure how women are participating on patent teams and whether they are participating on patent teams. And I'll just say a bit about African-American inventors as well. For previous data, there really wasn't any. Most studies have been of, if we're focusing on race and ethnicity, they had been of Chinese and Indian inventors and mainly focused on Silicon Valley. Certainly they've been, there have been case studies, for example, historical great inventors that Raymond Fouché wrote about. There have been collections of biographies. For example, Patricia Sluby has several of these. And we were writing, it was really funny, we were writing at the same time in 2004. She had been working on this book and I was putting together a patent data set. So it was really interesting that we were working at the same time. So for African Americans, the challenge was slightly different, and I was trying to match them to Black names. I started searching on Black names to identify people in the African-Americans in the PAT data set, but this was not as fruitful as I thought it would be because those are the Black names that we see in the literature, say the literature that was popular in the mid-2000s. These are post-civil rights era names. So you would need to be born in the 1960s and the 1970s, especially in the 1970s, to have one of those names, to start having one of those names. But many of the inventors in the data set I was looking at, say from 1970 forward, they were fully grown adults by that period. So matching isn't so easy. So had to use a number of other methods like biographies. I had to go to obituaries. There's a lot that I had to do to try to identify more African-American patentees by creating the universe of potential patentees. And I'll just tell you what I finally came up with. Between 1963 and 2006, 1,861 patents, 425 inventors. Today, we use many more methods like artificial intelligence, like machine learning, to try to identify women and African Americans. But there is a big caveat there. I just mentioned problems associated with matching, or not problems, but the way names that are not standardly American or English sounding names, may be assigned to more than one gender. So you have to be very careful about those, for example. And with respect to African Americans, often these data are trained on census data, and there are well-known problems associated with African Americans being under-identified in census data. So if you are training the data on census data sets, of course, those problems are magnified when you use machine learning, when you use AI. So you have to be super careful about these methods today. So again, I was using something that was a lot cruder than the methods we have today. I was using commercial software for African Americans. This also took advantage of increasing residential segregation. And this is what I wound up with from the new matching process. Over 4,000, close to 5,000 patents, over 1,600 inventors. And these post-civil rights era Black names are more present than in the historical data sets that I've used. And this is something that the software exploits. So when the data merged, there are over 6,500 patents, over 2,000 inventors, and 305 African-American women inventors. And that's important for what I'll be talking about later. But one thing that I want to emphasize again is that this is the first time that African Americans had been identified when I started doing this research in the patent data systematically. When I started doing this research in the early 2000s, I was counseled by senior women in economics not to do any research that focused on women, not to do any research that focused on African Americans, because I would never get tenure. I was told that journal editors were not interested in women, or research on women. They were not interested in research on African Americans, and I would never get tenure. This is what I was canceled. So I am glad that I, in that instance, that I'm hard-headed. I am not always glad that I am hard-headed or determined, a more charitable interpretation of that. But I am glad to see much more of this research being done. I am glad that many others are proving them wrong. So what do we learn from the data that I collected using these methods? So before the previous research, we found that it was 9% lower with respect to commercialization for women. After using these new methods, I found that it was only 4% lower. So that's what I mean by the commercialization gap or assignment to firms closing. For African Americans, it was 59% before I applied these methods, and after applying these methods, it was 69%, which is the same for women. So one thing that I want to stress is that even though it seems as though this is a good thing, I also measured this against historical data. And one thing that I found was that the peak year, still the peak year, even using 2010 data as this research uses, even then, the peak for African-American per capita invention is still 1899. Even when using 2010 data, there's a lot that I talk about in my 2014 paper that will elucidate that, but it's still much lower than it was in the past and much lower than the African-American population. So it's something to worry about. I looked at particular firms that are publicly traded. And what I found was that there was 50% assignment in the period 1976 to 1980 and 47% assignment in the period 1990 to 2000. For women, it was only 6% lower. And by 1990 to 2000, it was 7% higher or 54%. So this is in the largest firms. the publicly traded firms and the highest valued, well, actually, that's not necessarily true, not necessarily the highest valued firms, but let's say the publicly traded firms. Those are the largest, some of the largest firms. For African Americans in the period 1976 to 1980, they were lower, and in 4% lower, and in 1990 to 2000, they were 7% higher, 54%, which is comparable to women. So at the most valuable, some of the most valuable firms, publicly traded firms, African Americans and women were having greater success, or are having greater success. It's somewhat of an anomaly. But I'll tell you one more thing that I found that is one of the most durable findings of my research, is that single-sex patent teams are worse at invention than mixed-gender teams. So single-sex male, single-sex female teams are worse than mixed-gender patent teams. And I found that striking because as a person who attended a women's college, of course I thought that the patent teams that were all women were going to be the most productive teams. I am open to learning something all the time. So that suggests to me that these mixed gender teams make this case for diversity, that diversity, when it is executed along many different dimensions, is good for innovation. And these are the ones who commercialize their inventions more than the other two groups. So if CEOs, if chief innovation officers are not seeking to make sure that patent teams are integrated along many dimensions, such as gender, such as race, such as ethnicity, then they're leaving money on the table. And I'll say more about that in just a moment. So again, this is one of the most interesting findings that has been empirically supported by economists and subsequently in other fields. One more finding that I'll just mention is in terms of quality. There's increasing quality among women and African-American inventors in the US patent data. Median forward citations, the number of patent citing and inventors patent, are competitive with or higher than those for all and US patentees in all categories. Of course, citation rates vary by technological categories, but this is true for all categories, that the quality of patents is rising. But there's still less patent activity for US patents. This is 235 patents per million for the US population. For women, it's 40 patents per million. And for African Americans, it's 6 patents per million, or one order of magnitude less for women relative to all US inventors, and then 6 patents per million, or one order of magnitude lower than for women for African Americans. So if we're looking at women and women inventors using counts of inventors or using multiple inventors, we see whether you use one measure or the other, you see this increasing. For African Americans, and you should use the left scale to measure them. This is what it is, just doing the count. And then for US inventors, this is the right-hand scale. So you see greater participation by women. It's hard to see for African Americans. And for all inventors look more like U.S. inventors. And just to be clear, the share of U.S. inventors is falling in the U.S. patent data. These are residents of the U.S. The residents, the share of residents of other countries is increasing over that period. And this shows the shift in technological categories that women are patenting in. Remember that I said that drugs and medicine would be where we would expect to find women because of their degrees in biology, the PhDs in biology. But we don't see this. We see it rising over time, but it seems like it should have been there from the very beginning. But we see them participating on chemical patents, and we see them participating the least on computer and communications patents in some decades, but that's not consistent across time. Electronic or electrical patents would also be where they're participating less. And for African Americans, again, this has changed over time. Similar pattern to women in the sense that they participated on chemical patents more than any others over time. But what we see here is rising participation by African Americans on computer and communications patents. So in terms of the questions I would like to answer and that I would like to continue to answer, what are the determinants or correlates of patent and commercialization activity among women and African-American inventors? What explains gender and racial gaps, relatively higher commercialization activity and relatively lower patent activity? This conundrum that we just saw. And why is this important? Why is identifying missing women important? Because this has implications for income, wealth, and GDP at each stage. Again, education, training, and commercialization. So we see inequality at each stage, whether we're talking about participation in STEM fields or we're talking about participation in the practice of invention. This has implications for economic growth. What my co-author Yan-Yan Yang and I found was that GDP per capita could be 4.4% higher. If women and African-Americans participated, more women and African-Americans participated in the innovation economy. So what about policy prescriptions? We're leaving money on the table. If more women and let's talk about just women for the moment, more women participated, we would all see higher living standards. There is a macroeconomic implication of not having more women. So there are some things we could do that I've written about recently. On the supply side or the pipeline side, we could implement more mentoring programs. We have more research that shows that exposure to inventors improves life outcomes, including the probability that one will become an inventor. We could also count better. At the USPTO, they are counting more women. The Success Act that is based on my 2011 paper and the IDEA Act, so that was passed in 2019. And the IDEA Act that is making its way through Congress now are both based on my paper. And I am grateful that they are, but what they're trying to do is to count who's participating in innovation better. There can also be a lot more on the demand side with respect to the climate in which people working in the innovation economy are working. This working environment can be improved for women. For example, providing better childcare options. There's a big debate about that right now, about the care economy. Sexual harassment and sexual assault can be minimized. Certainly, racism and sexism are some of the biggest threats to the free flow of ideas, and they should be minimized at every juncture. And those who are leading innovation activities should make sure that those are minimized and addressed. What we have seen recently, more than in the past, is more strikes at tech firms, for example, and we see unions being formed at tech firms, and they're not arguing for better salary. What they're arguing for is better working conditions, including, for example, working against forced mediation when there's a sexual harassment claim. So I think these working conditions could help augment not just participation by women and African Americans, but could augment living standards, could increase our innovative capacity. So let's talk about the missing lattices. So why am I calling this the missing lattices? Well, first of all, NCWIT is honoring Dr. Gladys West with the NCWIT Pioneer in Tech Award. And I am just thrilled to see this. Pioneering women in innovation are not always missing. Sometimes they are sitting in plain sight and they are not celebrated like other inventors. So I am just delighted that NCWIT is focusing on Dr. Gladys West and giving her her flowers, giving her her due, and awarding her this award based on her research, her pioneering research on GPS technology. We know it wasn't easy, and we are so grateful. I am so grateful during Black History Month to be able to talk about Dr. Gladys West and not just George Washington Carver and Madam C.J. Walker. So thank you so much for that. There are inventors who are living and living role models for all of us. Again, thank you, NCWIT, for reducing the number of women who are missing in innovation. And I would encourage all of us to reduce this number and not only identify them, but celebrate them as well. Thank you so much for your attention, and I look forward to your questions.
I'm muted. Thank you so much, Dr. Cook. That was so good. We do have some questions. I want to start with, what would be your first action item on a solution plan to engage the underrepresented in the process of commercialization of innovation?
I know I was being very facetious at the end about Black History Month and about Women's History Month. Just, you know, a lot of dead people are trotted out as if innovation was great in the past. What I'd like to see is living inventors, living people who contribute to innovation trotted out during that period. And I also would like to see more visits to Spark Lab, for example, at the Smithsonian, at the Lemelson Center for the Study of Invention and Innovation in Washington. This is for children, but there's a lot that you can learn about the process of innovation. They walk in and they don't have an invention. When they walk out, they have an invention. And what does that do to children? It gives them a sense, or anybody, it would do it to anybody, gives them a sense that their ideas are valuable, that their curiosity is valued, and that anyone can contribute to invention and innovation. And I think that is at the top of my list. Now that we know that exposure to inventors can augment the probability of a child becoming an inventor, we should exploit that to the maximum. And we should put people who are living examples like Dr. Gladys West in front of people, in front of children, in front of those who are practicing invention and innovation as much as we can.
Yes, we are so excited to give Dr. Gladys West her roses today. She definitely more than deserves them. You actually kind of led into the next question that we had for you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you an idea, kind of a concept, and I want to hear your reaction to it, okay? Mm-hmm. So if we want more women and African Americans or Black people to invent more, should we start marketing to or encouraging those groups to invent at an even earlier your age, perhaps as early as middle school? And if so, how might we do that more effectively?
I think that's a good question. And as you said, I sort of led into it by advertising Spark Lab, as I always do. There should be a Spark Lab everywhere. And I know that they aren't just in Washington, D.C. There are different ones around the country. But that should be brought, it should be mobile, and it should be brought into the classroom. And rather than, you know, Black children especially are penalized sometimes for just being themselves. They're penalized earlier and earlier, let's say, by police officers in schools. Black women are disciplined more than Black girls are disciplined more than all their other counterparts. And that's increasing. That is the antithesis of what we want to see. If we want to augment curiosity, there was a child who built a clock, and I can't think of where exactly it was in Texas, but it was in Texas. And he brought it to school and he was arrested. He was dragged out of school. Homeboy just wanted to be on time. He just wanted to figure out an interesting way to tell time. And we have to identify and augment curiosity in many different places and encourage people, because ideas can come from any quarter. Nobody has a patent on where ideas can come from. They don't just come from white men. They come from many different types of people and from many different types of things. So I think that's the first thing that I would like to do, is to reshape the way we think about who can contribute to the intellectual capacity, the innovative capacity of a country and to our country.
Thank you. So this next question comes from someone who is a member of NSBE, and she's heard from their intellectual property special interest group that African Americans don't file patents on their own because it isn't even thought of, even at the PhD level, right? Do you think that colleges and universities will move to promoting intellectual property in the future? Is that a wise move? How do you feel about that?
I think they will, and we've seen that growing over time. There are more colleges and universities that have tech transfer offices, for example. So I really believe that will increase. There's just a lot of heterogeneity across universities. I mean, you know, Stanford has been doing this a long time, and a lot of companies have grown up through Stanford University, including Google, for example. So where Larry Page and Sergey Brin were graduate students. So I think that this is happening, but I would say that more of it needs to happen. For example, in the private sector, Bell Labs used to be the model of mentoring for graduate students, for women and underrepresented minorities. And there, people learned, like Lonnie Johnson learned at NASA government labs in these internships, how to file a patent. And I think it is something that is critical. You can learn how to do that a little bit at Spark Lab, or you can learn that you should do it at Spark Lab. But I think this is something that is underrated. So I thank the NSBE member for bringing that up.
Yes, thank you. Okay, so next question. Can you explain a little bit more about why commercialization is the most important indicator of participation?
I wasn't saying that it was the most important indicator. It is the one that I use in research because it is easily discoverable on patent records, right? It is the one, in my view, that is most important when you're thinking about wealth inequality, because that is where IPOs come into existence. And what we know about the top seven firms in the United States, and what we know about the top seven billionaires in the world is that they are associated in some way with a tech firm that at some point was an idea that was protected by intellectual property that got commercialized. So that's why I'm saying that this is extremely important for wealth inequality. And so I've told you why it's extremely important for wealth, for the valuation of firms. But let me give you one more statistic that will bridge that gap. 5% of founders receiving venture funding are women. 1% are African Americans. 0.2% are Black women. So if we're talking about, I know this is one proxy, this is crude. Most firms don't receive venture capital, but I'm just talking about the ones that do. That summarizes the kind of access and the kind of participation that that we see with respect to women and with respect to African Americans. Something has got to change. If we're saying that mixed gender teams are the most productive, that we can get greater GDP with the participation of more women and more African Americans, we've got to do something differently. That's how you get more women and African Americans in the innovation economy. And there seems to be a bottleneck.
Yeah. Okay, let's squeeze in one more question.
Sure.
Okay. What role, if any, do you feel violence may still play in the disproportionately low number of patent filings from Black people and other minoritized identities? And maybe not violence, like physical violence, but even violence as a concept or a construct.
Right, sure, sure. Well, you know, in the period that I have studied the most, in the period 1870 to 1940, it gave African Americans a sense of a fear, and they stopped patenting as a result of that kind of violence. So if you see it, I remember one of the reviewers in a journal, or several reviewers actually at several economics journals, asked me why an African American in one state would be concerned about the lynching of an African American in another state. Well, we see post George Floyd, I mean, we didn't have to wait for that. Many of us knew before that. There's a sense of fear. There is a constant sense of fear. And what I am saying is that this is the antithesis. You've got to have an open society where people don't live in fear of being stopped by the police, for example, during routine operations, during a routine traffic stop or routine activities, even in the classroom. Again, women and Black women and Black boys are being disciplined much more than other groups, and they're losing out on this augmentation of curiosity. That's where it happens. And if you're dragging them out of the classroom, you're going to minimize the kind of curiosity they're going to have. It's not safe to be curious, not safe for them to be there. So I think this is something that is ongoing and that has to be addressed systematically.
Wow, thank you so much. That was amazing. I think that we are going to wrap it up. Dr. Cook, like, it's been such a pleasure kind of having this conversation with you. I think that economics is probably a subject that I understand like the least, but the economics of racism and sexism sounds just so like, I want to know more about this. So I was really excited to kind of learn more about you and the work that you've done and all of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me. And congratulations again, Dr. West.
Okay, so I am going to reshare and we are going to keep going.
Bye-bye now.
Thank you. And thank you so much, Dr. Cook. Okay. So let's go from here. We are going to keep it going. In case you missed it, don't forget to order your virtual summit swag box featuring an issue of NCWIT's Rethink magazine. You'll also get some fun goodies, and it's good. It's fun. So definitely get on there, order your box. Supplies are limited. We will run out. So if you have not ordered one, be sure to visit ncwit.org and order your 2021 swag box. Stay with us for our next segment, the 2021 Pioneer in Tech Award. As Dr. Cook mentioned, we are honoring Dr. Gladys West, and we are so excited to have a conversation with her and to hear about her amazing work. So stay tuned. So now I would like to welcome Lucy Sanders, the co-founder and CEO of NCWIT, to introduce the 2021 NCWIT Pioneer in Tech Award. Hi, Lucy. We're excited to have you on today.
Well, hi. I hope you can see me and hear me.
Yes, we can.
Oh, perfect. Well, welcome everybody to one of my favorite events of the year, the Honoring the Pioneer in Tech. I don't think I could do a better intro than what Dr. Lisa Cook just did in terms of why it's so important that we recognize the women who have come before us in terms of their technological innovations and contributions, and why? Well, because we can recognize them. They certainly deserve it. We can also learn from them. They can serve to inspire us and future generations. And so at NCWIT, we really believe in this fully, and every year we look for an honoree. And you know, sometimes people go, well, we didn't know who that was. And it's so important that we get the message out that we have so many great innovators that need to be recognized in this way. So today we're honoring Dr. Gladys West with the 2021 Pioneer in Tech Award from NCWIT. Dr. West, I have to say, is so amazing. She earned her PhD at the age of 70 years old. And she got a master's in mathematics from Virginia State College, which is now Virginia State University. She was hired by the Navy at the Dahlgren, Virginia location in 1956, and she worked there for 42 years. At the time of her hiring, she was only the second Black woman who had ever been hired and one of only four Black employees. She is perhaps well known for her mathematical modeling for the development of satellite, and I had to look up how to say this, y'all, geodesy models that were eventually incorporated into the global positioning or GPS systems that we use so much today. So she is a technological innovator, and we're so excited to honor her with this award. I do know, though, that, you know, we hear that, you know, she's the brains behind a lot of the mathematical computation in GPS today, but she also likes maps and loves to trust her own brain in reading maps, and it made me kind of want to go pull out a map, my atlas, and go look to see if I could still read that. So we are tremendously excited. This is absolutely one of my favorite things that we do at NCWIT. So before we hear from Dr. West, I think we'd like to play a video, which has sort of a short recap of her life and career.
When I grew up as a little girl, I was in a country area, rural area, and we made our living by having a farm. I told myself that I did not like being out in the sun and working from sunrise to sunset and all that, so I made good grades in all of my subjects. So it's time to go to college. Well, since you're doing well in all subjects, you can major in math. And we know that you'll be successful. So when I went to college, I majored in math. Graduated after 4 years. I had applied for jobs in the government. I got hired in Darwin in 1956. I came by myself. My husband wasn't with me or anything. I was by myself. I at least put it this way, I didn't know him at that time. At the same time that we were coming to work here, they were also bringing in a large computer, and they hired these mathematicians to learn to work this computer. We hadn't had any computer teaching or knowledge, so we had to master this job that they want us to do. So we had to learn how to program and code for this big computer. My part in the global positioning system would be working more with the orbit over the water. A lot goes into the scientific computation to generate an orbit, which is a database used in GPS. So the different people who did civilian applications learned to use the database that we generated, and that was the foundation that GPS was built on. When you grew up as a black girl, our school was separated from the white schools, and we had separate buses. And many times we would get the old hand-me-down things from the white school, books that weren't new like their books were. But all of that helped to make us, I think, work harder because, you know, you were behind the eight ball to start with, you know, so you had to work harder. But I always was motivated by doing something new and completing something, having a goal. Because usually I had a mind of my own. I tend to think for myself, a little impatient with others who don't think the way I do.
Well, thank you very much. That's a great video. And I'd like to now ask Dr. West to join us on camera and make a few remarks, and after which we will have an interview, a short Q&A session.
Dr. Good afternoon. Thank you for those wonderful words that was just given. I am extremely honored to receive the Pioneer in Tech Award. I am very thankful to NCWIT for the recognition. Many years ago, I committed myself to be the best that I could be. Through my successes and challenges, I stayed focused and persevered, never losing sight of my goals. Being recognized at this point in my life brings some closure to a long and committed journey. I have recently published my memoirs entitled, It Began with the Dream. I had many thoughts and dreams that dominated my thinking throughout my developmental years. I encourage each of you to always move confidently toward your dreams yourselves. I would like to say thank you to all who have helped me along the way. I thank God for all that he has done and for continuing to oversee my life. Thank you again to NCWIT for giving me this great honor. I will always cherish it. Thank you.
It's wonderful. And we're so happy to see the award is there. So that's awesome. We are excited to have you here today to do some short Q&A, and we're not the only ones honoring you, Dr. West. I have a letter here from Eddie Bernice Johnson, who is the US Congress chairwoman of the Science Committee. And I'd like to just read it here. And I believe we sent it to your daughter, so she has a copy too, in case you haven't seen it. but it's really wonderful to be honored. Chairwoman Johnson sponsored the Hidden Figures Gold Medal Act that cleared Congress, I think, about a year ago. And so I'll just read it, if I may. Modern day America was built upon the contributions of talented engineers and mathematicians such as yourself. Your service to this country is a living testimony to the trailblazing abilities in women with their eyes set on the future. It makes me sad. I'm just so excited. So great. From your foundational modeling work on the original global positioning system to your work on the CSAT remote sensing technology, your brilliance, hard work, and dedication have yielded lasting benefits to society. As chairwoman of the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, and throughout my 28 years in Congress, I have worked to ensure a continuing federal commitment to empowering our nation's scientists so that they can do what they do best. And I thank you for your pioneering efforts. As the second African-American woman ever to be hired at the then Naval Proving Ground, you exemplified persistence, humility, and excellence that serves as a model to students, particularly women and students of color. I have no doubt that careers like yours will inspire the next generation of diverse women engineers, mathematicians, programmers, and inventors. I was thrilled to lead the effort to enact legislation to honor the hidden figures like you. You are one more example whose contributions to society have been overlooked. It is a privilege to share sisterhood with you in Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. I cannot think of a more deserving awardee and offer my congratulations on your recognition as an NCWIT pioneer in tech. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And now I'd like to introduce TJ Aladdin from the NCWIT staff, who manages our community of students. Dr. West, we have thousands of students across the United States who will be inspired by you, and she's got some questions to ask you.
Thank you so much, Lucy, and thank you even more, Dr. West. I am TJ Aladdin, as Lucy said, and I have the honor of interviewing you today. Here at my job, I get to manage 20,000 women in tech nationwide between high school and their first 2 years in the workforce. And in honor of you, I did the math by hand, and I have worked at NCWIT for 1,822 days. I promise you I did not Google that. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for all that you have contributed to the world. So my first question for you is, how would you describe yourself to someone who has never met you before? There have been so many articles written about you by other people in Forbes and The Guardian, so on and so forth. But I would really love to know, what would you say to someone who has never heard of you before?
Yeah, I think I see myself a little bit different from others many times, because I feel so humble and dedicated and concerned about whatever I'm involved in. I just feel like it's a privilege for me to be smart enough to understand what the big fuss is all about, what the world is doing. And I believe like having a plan, working on a plan, setting goals and working those goals, and keep doing that and making sure that I'm meeting them and I'm reaching what I want to do at stages, and just continue to do that. not so much having a whole lot of fun, but always being busy all the time, dedicated to what I'm involved in. And so sometimes I get discouraged by myself and I say, well, you should be having more fun or doing other things, but I have no desire. And I just sort of stay there working and trying to resolve what it is that I'm involved in. So I'm just so happy that other people are recognizing this and giving me these awards. This is wonderful. Thank you.
Well, I at least hope that we can have a little bit of fun today. We'll try and squeeze in some fun. My next question is based on what you just said about how you continue to work towards different projects and like initiatives. How do you find the motivation to keep going, especially as a woman in mathematics? The numbers are still quite low. How do you find the strength to continue to do the work that you do?
Yeah, I don't know. I think maybe setting the goals, and so your timeline is just that goal at the time, and you sort of reach that goal, so that's an incentive. That was my excitement point, is to reach a goal that you've been working on and seeing that you can do it and then trying something else. So you sort of incite yourself, keep going. And so I don't have any problem with, not continuing, but I do have a problem with not being busy all the time. I want to be doing something, working something. So that's me.
That's awesome. I feel the same. I like to stay super busy all the time. So we both have to work on trying to squeeze in some fun. So as I mentioned before, I get to manage a very large community of people. And I have a question in honor of the 10th and 12th graders at the Cristo Rey High School in Brooklyn and their teacher, Mr. Bernard. They are curious to know what advice for them you have at this stage to keep pushing forward, because math is hard. So what advice do you have for them?
Well, we're finding out now in today's society that more information about STEM is being provided. There are more activities, more events, more people getting involved. And so that is always a source where they can join some of the groups in their community and take advantage of that. And even in schools also, some of the teachers are beginning to be very conscious of STEM. And I always sort of feel like you find yourself a person who's interested in it and then talk to them, have them help you, help direct you to where you would like to go. You may not know exactly what your final point is or what you're finally interested in, but ask for some guidance. And you got to work and you got to sort of spend some time digging yourself. You shouldn't sit and wait for somebody else to come show you the way and push you along. You got to be curious and you got to just talk to other people and move along. You can almost tell all the kids who are going to really excel real fast because they're so curious about life in general and testing and trying things.
Thank you so much for that response. And I think that was excellent advice for those students. And I think they're going to cherish it forever and ever. I know I will. I want to just cue the audience now. You can start to submit any questions that you have into the Q&A. I'm going to continue to ask Dr. West some more questions, but in a moment we will get to your questions. So my next question for you, Dr. West, is about you getting your PhD. Okay, what? So you accomplished all of these amazing things, you retired, and then you went back and got a PhD. And you were still the only Black woman in your course. Was that surprising to you?
Yeah, I guess surprising that I was the only Black woman at that time. I would have thought there were some others. But I didn't really ever quit school. When I retired, I had all my coursework done. I had done all the basic work done for the PhD. So it looks like I started back, but I didn't start back. And I had had all the experience of working with the men who were in the program along with me, and learning a lot about how they were and resolving issues like who's smarter than who and all that kind of thing. I had all those experiences. And now I just and left that at the end to say, I got to settle down, I'm free, I can do it. And so I just attacked it and got the dissertation written and graduated.
That is amazing and so inspiring. I have a master's degree. I'm pursuing another master's degree. And now that I know, I have another 40 or 50 years if I want to get my PhD, because you have charted that path for me now, so I can see something different. Yeah, so thank you for that. I want to ask about something you mentioned before, which is about staying humble. So I don't know, but if somebody wrote about me in Forbes, I don't know if I could stay too humble. So you are being talked about worldwide now. You're being recognized for work that you've done. Has that changed you at all?
It changed me in the sense that in my heart, I feel a lot of what people are expressing. I feel that. But outwardly, I still feel like I need to step softly and look and make sure where I'm going, because I don't feel like I did it. You know, I feel like I had some blessings. I have a feeling that somebody else was steering the ship and I was just on the ship. And because there's so many people who have helped me that I never thought that they were helping me and made it possible. Even I had a lady who took care of the house while I was with my head down in the books and stuff, you know. But that was very important because it gave me comfort and security that things were all right at home. So I'm thankful. I'm as excited as those people are talking outward, but inwardly, I'm still humble about what I have done. I'm just feeling blessed.
Yes. Yeah, I am feeling blessed to have this opportunity to chat with you. I really love that you mentioned all of the people around you that helped to support you on your journey. Who would you say was the most impactful person for you as you were pursuing your goals?
I would say that probably my mother was the most impactful, I would think. But then, as I look back along the way, there were a lot of others also, because I didn't have a lot of money, so I had to get a job. So I worked at the home of a math professor and a physics professor. And so even though that they didn't always just labor and talk to me exactly about what to do and all, but they were really gold models, and I was eyeing them, what they were doing, and I was sort of following their guide as the way I should be going. How should I carry myself? What should I do? How hard should I work? What I, you know, and I was getting all of this, so they had a big impact on me also, and I tried to pick friends also that were a positive influence also. So I guess I've been surrounded by some wonderful people that I didn't know. I thought I was doing everything, but I was just sort of copying a whole lot of what was around me.
That's really great to hear that you had so many different people supporting you along your journey, including men. I think that's excellent. We don't hear enough, I think, about the people that get it right, and that this is a problem that all genders need to come together and solve. So thank you for sharing that. Mm-hmm. I have a question for you from the audience, which is, you have set and met countless goals in your life. What do you feel most proud of looking back now?
Well, I think what I feel most proud of is just reaching the top. I just accomplished everything that I had planned to do and got to the end and was feeling like, oh boy, I still feel like I ought to be working. So then I started on something else. And so even though I worked hard and I did a lot of things, I still feel like as long as I have energy and can work, that I should be helping the world. My goal is getting bigger and bigger, I guess. I should help the world in general to arise and be counted also. So I started getting interested in the young people and telling them my story and just having fun now at my age and my energy.
I was actually going to ask about how you get, what do you eat in the morning that you can accomplish all of these things?
Well, and not that we eat anything so particular, it's that we eat, I think. We always ate healthy breakfasts and lunches and all, partly because I was on the farm, that's where I got started. So we're eating now well-balanced meals 3 times a day, and that helps. But I think it's more the inner workings of you, how dedicated you, how serious you are, how do you feel about the world and your role in it, and understanding what's happening in the world and how much we need each other, to get further along and to make the world a better place to live in and all. And so if you really see how big that problem is, you gladly want to do your part. Let me do my part to hold up this end. And I do feel like I need to work for myself, be independent, stand up and be counted. And I do that all the time.
Amazing, thank you so much. I have another question from the audience, and it's a bit of a long question, so bear with me. The Atlantic recently published an article that referenced the idea that women should follow the norms of male-dominated industries in order to be successful. So essentially, women should do what the men do in certain careers in order to achieve success. What advice can you offer to Black and Brown women in these kinds of white male-dominated spaces who are trying to be successful without necessarily conforming to that particular culture?
Yeah, that's a tough one. I don't agree with a whole lot of it, but we do know that we all are different. We all are individuals, we're separate, we have our own minds, and somebody on our level don't guide us and carry us where we need to go. We are independent and work according to our own thinking and doing. So I think anybody can do any work who is interested and really want to put the time and effort and we get it right and share and connect with others and let them know what you're doing and how you're doing it and be a role model for people who don't believe in women. You know, women don't have to stand back and cry. Some are really born with a lot of strength and courage, and they are fighting from the beginning. And we all are different, very different. And I just not completely clear and understand their thinking. But anyway, I think we can do it.
I agree with you 100%. And it's really great to hear that you don't agree with that line of thinking that women should change themselves. I think that alone will be very encouraging to the women listening to you right now. I have another question, which is about the support that you can get from groups. So as I mentioned before, I have the privilege of managing a group of 20,000 women in tech. And I know that you are a member of the AKA sorority. Mm-hmm. I know it's a bit different, but I'm just curious to know what it was like for you to be a member of that group. What supports did you get? And do you recommend that in order to get support from peers that women find, you know, find a group of people?
Well, I don't know that absolutely necessary, but during the time that I was connected with AKA Roy, we just didn't have a whole lot of shoulders to stand on. And all, and this lady I lived with, who was a math professor, and a friend, they would always be talking about the big meetings they had to go to, and what they had to do, and who they saw there, and who was there. Well, anyway, but in my head, I was getting pictures of these educated women, and we didn't have that many women to like look at and stand up and be role models, you know. So hearing them talk about this group of women, and then when the lady recommended that I join AKA at the time, and I did many years ago, but when I went to my first big conference, the Boulay, I saw all of these Black women, and just 10,000 maybe Black women, and that was really impressive to me, and because we hadn't seen many, and they were everything that I had imagined in my mind that a professional Black woman would look like and act like. And so for me, it was a role model. It would help me because I tried to emulate, you know, some of what I was seeing. And so this other AKA always was sort of business, like, you know, work hard, did it right, no playing around. So I tend to get that same kind of modeling for myself. And so I don't think you have to be in a group that big, but I do think you have to have something that's complementary to your way of thinking, you know.
Thank you so much. That's excellent, excellent advice. And yes, the 20,000 women in our group are gonna take that on for sure. I have a few more questions for you, and then I have some special folks that I want you to meet. So I have a little surprise coming later, but I want to know specifically because you're from a rural area. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, the farm was the thing, it was the place to be, but you did not want to be there. Even nowadays, we find that a lot of the focus on recruiting young folks in STEM happens in the big cities and on the coasts. So I'm wondering if you have any advice for folks who are looking for more talent, how can we reach more students in rural areas?
I think it's easier now. I guess what we were doing would be sending out women on the job, we're sending out recruiters from the job, looking for the kind of people that we needed. And also for the kind of people that you could work with, and that, you know, because it's more than just the technical. Again, we have to attend some of the sessions where people are having activities that talk about their schools and what they're doing, what kind of work they do. You have to sort of tap in a little bit to the university also, and sort of be aware of all of the things that you are looking for in a person on the job. And that is, sometimes it's not easy to see that far before job to after job. But you can tell the people who want to be of value, want to add to what you have, listen to. And you have to have people who can tap into that inner part also, in addition to the technical points that you want to get covered.
I think that's just so amazing to hear from you, because we often focus only on the technical skills. Can this code? Can they do math? And I think that you're right that we sometimes miss out on the other skills that actually are going to help that person to do the, you know, do the job, to, you know, persevere. Yeah. So yeah. Thank you for that. Okay, one more question, and then some special guests will be here. I want to know from you, what changes have you seen in the past decade or so that are inspiring to you?
Well, there's been a lot of changes, I guess, and they're made pretty fast. It's hard to keep up with them. I guess at a very early time when I was younger, I didn't even know anything about STEM. So now we have more STEM activities that are popping up. And from what I'm gathering, they're being really advantageous to a lot of the young people and to the girls, and how they are stepping up and taking a part in what's available for them. And the more youth are getting involved in this, in schools, and also in, we have a little museum close by, and in this little museum where there are people who have children in high school and all, who are interested in these kind of activities to put their children in. So they join the museum and they come to a lot of these activities and projects and robot training and all kinds of things. There is just more people trying to get their people into this to learn more about STEM. And I think that it's working. So we are inspiring them.
I am living proof that that is working. Growing up, I wanted to be a dancer. I still kind of want to be a dancer. I decided to pursue a career in science. And that is largely due to women like you and the work that you still continue to do. So thank you again so much. And now I want to invite Claudia and Crystal to come on camera. Claudia and Crystal are two of our Change Leader Scholars. These are women in college who are pursuing technology and who want to come and tell you a bit about themselves and to congratulate you. So Claudia and Crystal, please join us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Dr. West. I'm absolutely honored to be here and to be congratulating you for this award. My name is Claudia Hernandez, and I'm majoring in computer science and plan to pursue special interests in artificial intelligence, machine learning, astronomy, and business. And I want to say hearing about your story is absolutely astonishing. You've been a huge inspiration to me and to my efforts. The emphasis that you put on educating girls in STEM has been a real inspiration to my efforts in trying to not only make an impactful contribution to STEM itself, but also to open the door to bring other women into STEM. So as a female majoring in computer science, I think that it's incredibly important to share stories like yours. Mm-hmm. I started a community coding club and a national resource website to help educate women and to bring them into the field and inspire them. And sharing stories with changemakers like you has been incredibly, incredibly impactful into their interest and their belief that they can, in fact, pursue and succeed in STEM. I mean, being a groundbreaking programmer and mathematician whose models and algorithms were crucial to advancing both our understanding of the world and creating GPS systems that billions use every day, all in the face of adversity, your excellence motivates me to pursue my technological aspirations fearlessly and work harder to make a difference. And I'm sure millions of other girls can say the same.
Thank you so much. Oh, that's fantastic. Now that is a winner.
It's definitely an honor to meet you. And I just wanted to say that I thank you for your relentless determination, your love of learning, your incredible journey, and ultimately your revolutionary innovations and how you've helped pave the way for women in STEM, especially women of color, to thrive in the field. You're an inspiration to me and women everywhere, and I am honored to offer you this award that is long overdue. You're truly a pioneer for women in tech, and I'd like to congratulate and thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This is wonderful.
And now Crystal will share some words as well.
Thank you so much for this opportunity today. Congratulations on the Pioneer in Tech Award from NCWIT, Dr. Gladys West. Your own work has impacted so much of our technology today and is a guiding light on what it means to do work ethically and on persisting regardless of being the first. So today, the percentage of Black mathematicians and computer scientists is still exceedingly low, and students from traditionally underrepresented groups who wish to excel in these fields often find themselves isolated and wondering if there is a place for them in this field. And role models like yourself are critical in making sure that talented students from traditionally underrepresented groups know that they can succeed. My own grad school journey started because a NASA mathematician who works in satellite remote sensing using GPS for climate science encouraged me to attend grad school. And my research focuses on applied cryptography, fairness, and machine learning, because I believe that regardless of which neighborhood you grew up in, you have a right to protect your data, and that data should be used fairly and ethically. Your story of resilience, hard work, and excellence has motivated me throughout my own studies and in reimagining the ways that we could chart our own paths, leave our own legacy, and in remembering that there is a place for us. I'm personally inspired by the fact that you still use paper maps over GPS and trust your intellect, because it shows a continued empathy towards accessibility and in understanding socio-technical and inclusive ways of thinking about technology and how the systems we make can impact the world. Mm-hmm. We as change leaders are all inspired by your purpose-driven life.
Thank you so much. I mean, that's beyond words. I just wish you luck in everything you're doing, both of you. That's wonderful. Make me fit now. I feel really honored that somebody is making decisions because of me.
I have one more for you. This Zoom space is about to get a lot more impressive and a lot smarter because Dr. Cook is about to join us again. Please come on camera, Dr. Cook.
Thank you so much. And Dr. West, I want to congratulate you. I want to just tell you what an inspiration you are. And I've been stalking you for about 20 years. I just want to let you know. and I'll tell you why. My aunt was the chair of the math department at Virginia State for about 20 years. She just passed away 2 years ago, and your paths are so incredibly similar. While she grew up in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, I grew up in Milledgeville, Georgia. Our sensibilities were those country sensibilities that you're talking about, where the values of the farm, the hard work of the farm were brought to us, and at the same time, the values related to STEM. All of my mom's family is steeped in STEM. So everybody's a mathematician, an engineer, math professor. So it never occurred to me that this was a skill that women were not supposed to have.
Yeah.
It was amazing. And when you talk about it just like she did, right? You know, I got the best grades. So they told me to go do math. Right? That's exactly what happened. And, you know, when she was teaching there, she just ran across so many people that she inspired in the way that you inspire people. And, you know, you, I'm sure, inspire many more people. Your technology has been deployed in so many different ways. And I'll tell you what, before I knew that you were such a pioneer in GPS technology, I used to ask my students, when I am teaching them economics and the economics of innovation, what innovations have been life-changing that you depend on the most? And they will say, and this is, okay, so I started teaching systematically in 2005. GPS is at the top of that list.
Oh, really?
GPS is at the top of that list. Now, you know, I primarily teach men, right? So this is a good thing. This is a public service. So they can get where they're supposed to go, and they're not circling the block, and they're not circling the earth in a long way. So we appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for those kind compliments. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cook. And thank you once more, Dr. West. Thank you as well to Claudia and Crystal for being here to also let you know how valued you are in the lives of women and all people today. I told you before that I did the math by hand and I worked at NCWIT for 1,822 days. And this is by far the best day of them all.
Oh,
I get the chance to honor you for all of your contributions and all the things that you're going to continue to contribute for many, many more years to come. Once again, congratulations and thank you so much, Dr. West.
Thank you so much for giving me this great honor. You know, I'm sure I'll begin to feel more and more honored to know that people are making changes to their life because of me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And now I'm going to invite Lucy Sanders, our CEO and founder, back on camera.
Well, thank you. Now I think you know why this is our most favorite part of the NCWIT Summit by far. You know, congratulations. I'm so wrapped up in your story and everything and the students and what they're talking about, and heartfelt congratulations, because we know you're not done yet. So make sure you stay in touch and let us know what you're up to. And we are just so thrilled to honor you with this award. I just don't want this to end, this whole conversation. It was so rich and so authentic. Yeah. And I just want to encourage people who are listening, this is a great recording to share out and to inspire others and to tell your story, Dr. West, to the thousands of people we interact with every year. Yeah. So do not doubt for a moment that you will not continue, you will continue to inspire people, right?
Thank you. Yeah.
It's awesome. So thank you so much.
Yeah,
for
that's what I want to do, continue to inspire them.
Yeah, don't worry, it's coming for sure. And thanks for joining us. I just have a few last minute housekeeping things to do before we close the summit out. And so I'm gonna ask Brittany to share her screen quickly and we'll take care of business here. Just another shout out to all of our sponsors who have made the summit possible. So thank you for your ongoing support.